Well, hi everybody. I'm Shane.
And I'm Sarah, and welcome to Lohre Farm.
Sarah and I were talking, and we thought we'd like to give you guys a tour of our property. We have 10 acres. Come along for the tour. This is up by the road, and unfortunately, one negative thing about our property is we have a pretty busy road most of the time. That's why Sarah and I are choosing to do it at this time of the night. And also, it's been really windy here the last couple of days, so this is kind of, we knew tonight was going to be a little bit more of a calm night and a good opportunity to come out here. So we planted these trees shortly after we moved in, I think in the first year, and I can't remember exactly what they all are. Do you?
So this one is a nectarine.
Nectarine, okay.
Yep. It's a zone 4. Actually, I think that one actually goes to a zone 3. This is a pear tree. We have some summer crisp, which are a really sweet, delicious pear. We have two of those. And then we have another one, I think it was a Barrett pear. Those aren't as pretty or as sweet, but they do taste quite nice.
Up here in the front of the property, we have a sign that I put up and made different signboards for when different vegetables are available. People can stop, and we have this vegetable cart that I made. For the most part, it's a donation stand more than anything. People stop, usually buy zucchini, cucumbers, tomatoes, whatever we've kind of got. We're really starting to get into, gonna have a lot of things available here in the next 2 weeks, so should be fun. Sarah and the kids got it all set up today, and it's looking good.
So these are apple trees. We have Macintosh.
Yeah, so the first one here is a Macintosh.
Honeycrisp.
And then we have Honeycrisp and Red Delicious. Basically, these were the trees that could cross-pollinate the best, so we planted them every other. put these in our very first year. We did lose one tree here down on the end, if I remember right.
Yes.
It was a Honeycrisp that we lost our first year, so we ended up replacing it with this cherry tree. We really haven't gotten much fruit off of them, and they probably are in desperate need of some proper pruning. So yeah, if I probably need to get on the YouTube and watch some videos, but I think what we probably ultimately need is to have somebody come out to the property and take a look at them and tell us exactly what needs to be done to make them better. These yellow flowers, do you know what these are? These yellow flowers, every year at about this time, they line the entire wooded area all the way around, and they're so pretty. Something I really always look forward to. So about half of our property is actually more of like a wooded area, and we made some trails out here to kind of come out and enjoy it and basically forage and figure out exactly what's out here. It's amazing how much stuff is actually out here. One of the things that we've found that we have an abundance of on our property is elderberry. Sarah came out here and kind of we whipped around this elderberry tree. I don't know if it's a tree or a bush. Elderberry bush, and that way we could do some harvesting off of it. And we found quite a bit more, and actually we plan to kind of designate one area on the property where we're gonna grow elderberries and harvest them. I said there's such an abundance of things growing out here naturally. I never would have dreamed when we moved here that we would be able to forage for as much as we can. But as you can see, it's pretty dense out here. Most of the trees that are growing are poplars. Pretty nice tall straight trees that grow really, really fast. And they're not the greatest firewood, but they grow fast. So that's one thing that's really cool. One of the things that Sarah and I have found that was pretty funny was when we bought the property, we ended up buying some raspberry bushes for quite a bit of money. And lo and behold, once we kind of started looking around the property, turns out that we have thousands of raspberry bushes just growing naturally all over. this area here is pretty thick with them. We're kind of right at the end of at least the first batch of raspberries for the year. So, oh, yep, there's some right there. But this is getting pretty close to the far east side of our property. I got a deer stand over here. And we got a little, it's actually a county drainage ditch that runs, that kind of separates us from the neighbor. I don't know if you can see that right down there, but that's that little drainage ditch I was talking about. And it just follows right along our property. Look at all that foot traffic. See how that's all smashed down? There's definitely been something in here eating raspberries. We do actually have, we have black bears. Haven't been a problem, thankfully, but we know that they're around, so wouldn't be surprised if from time to time they're making their way into the berry bushes. Either that or it's probably just the deer. Got quite a few deer around. These paths that I made were actually pretty tricky to make the very first time I came out here, but I think they were well worth it. We've sure enjoyed them. Come out here, walk around a little bit, enjoy the scenery, or if nothing else, just it's a nice little path to get out to the deer stand. And then if I get anything, able to drive the tractor back there to get it. What'd you find there? Some poison berries?
I don't know. I guess I've never noticed this before. That's some sort of berries. I gotta watch that one.
Well, we're basically walking up the east side to the north. To my left here, we have our pond, which you can barely see because the sun is getting pretty low in the sky and the glare is probably pretty bad, but we'll kind of circle around and I'll be able to show you guys that. We've done a lot of work in the last year on that, trying to make that a little bit better for habitat. Well, this trail here, this heads off to another deer stand that I've got over here. To the north, our property ends about 90 feet shy of that tall tree right there. So if you just come back about 90 feet from there, that's where it ends. All right, wait for me. I mentioned earlier that we have black bears around from time to time. We've definitely, myself and the neighbor, we've picked them up on the game cameras, and I don't know what it is. I think it's probably just an internal fear, but I think every time I'm out here mowing, when I come around this corner right here, I'm gonna run into one. I'm hoping that's not a premonition. At one point, I think most of this property was opened up for cattle grazing based on some of the fences and the old photos that I've seen. Most of this treed area here was actually more of like a pasture, and kind of where the house sits was actually where most of the trees were. So I'm pretty confident that the ground throughout here, even though it's quite heavily weeded, is actually pretty flat and smooth. And we do get water from time to time in the spring when the snow melts, but it seems to drain off pretty quickly through that drainage ditch or into the pond and dry up pretty good. Well, if you watched the video about the tractor, you saw me explain all the things down here on implement row, and over here on the other side from implement row and the path we just came out of, I kind of have a little area set up for where I can shoot archery or whatever, just kind of a little area set up. this building here on the back of the barn is what we usually call the tractor shed. And we kind of just use it for storage for now. I don't know, I'd like to do something with it, but we'll have to see. Maybe in the future, maybe we can put some animals or something in there, something fun. But for now, it's just kind of junk storage, so that's all right. And here on the back of the barn, we have a access door so that we can easily get into the chicken coop if we need to. And kind of wanted to wait to let these guys out so that you guys could see them. And otherwise, they'd be spread all over in the woods, and you probably wouldn't get to see them at all. So we got, I think, 25 chickens, quite a few different breeds. Barred Rock, there's our rooster there, big fat chicken. Talked about him in quite a few different videos. And for the most part, they get to just free range wherever they want all day long. We only have them locked up a few times a year when we're planting or there's seeds down, and we don't want them destroying any of that. Pretty much everybody's met Deuce the cat. What do you think, Deuce the cat? Oh, it looks like the ducks are up from the pond, probably wanting some food. That's usually the case. So on the other side here, we have another small coop that we made that works really, really good as a brooder coop. Basically has its own door inside, so that, hey, what are you doing in there? There's no cats allowed in the brooder coop. What are you doing, huh? This is where the kitties are living for right now, for a little bit of time. Except for, they probably don't spend much time in there. The kids are probably playing with them most of the day. So anyways, inside the barn, got the nesting boxes so that you can easily just come in there during the day and get eggs. And then on the back, I built this other stall so that we could have even more chickens, or a completely separate coop if we needed to separate them. And then there's kind of a pathway through so that we can open that up and give all the chickens much more room. And then in the main coop, got some perching areas for them. Hey, it's bedtime. You got to come down now.
Yeah, it's too high.
Yeah, come on. Let's go. It's bedtime. Well, this will be the most entertaining part of the whole video right here. Come on, Deuce, let's go. It's bedtime. All right, there we go. It's nice that I get to be on video too with the shadow. All right, good night, Deuce. So anyways, I don't know what we're gonna do with this area over here. I think it definitely would make a good area for some pigs, being that the lean over here is on the north side and protect them from the sun if they wanted it during the day, and could be a nice little area for them. So we'll have to see what the future brings. Next to that, we have our windmill. It's a 20-foot windmill, and actually the way that this is designed is it has a diaphragm up in it so that every time it turns, it flexes the diaphragm, and we can use it to aerate the pond. So it's pretty cool. It turns on 3 miles an hour, so it's pretty much turning every single day, almost all day long. It just happens to be extremely calm tonight for the first time in weeks and weeks and weeks. And over here, this is the new planter box garden area that we built for this year. Because of the pond renovation, we have a huge pile of dirt in the middle of our planting area, and we wanted to figure out an alternative, and we never really did much with this spot. We had a fire pit over here or something, and so this is gonna be really, really a nice little area here in the future. Actually, on the back side here, we're gonna build a permanent greenhouse that I'm really excited about. We've been gathering materials for it all summer. I'm hoping to build it for pretty much nothing. Maybe some screws or something like that, but we made the planter boxes this year, and we burnt them, preserve the wood a little bit better. they seem to be holding up pretty good. They're just made out of pallets. I did make a pretty big boo-boo though. I realized after I got them in here that if I would have turned them the opposite direction, I could have got twice as many planter boxes in this area as we have. So I know that as much as I don't want to do it, I think next spring or maybe later this fall, I'll be going through here and making that change so that we can get twice as many planter boxes in this area. So, but I'm really looking forward to the project of building the greenhouse. That's really going to be a cool thing to have done, have it be a permanent one. We've had decent luck growing in the temporary ones with the plastic, but that plastic doesn't last long and it's expensive. So it'll be nice to have something way more permanent. But the garden's growing great. Everything's coming along. It's amazing. Tons of tomatoes there. Absolutely a ton. That probably needs a lot of trimming, but going down here by the pond. All of this just got graded out and put back. You can see that the grass is starting to grow in here, and we're gonna get some ground cover down to keep everything from eroding. Last year when we had a really bad drought and the pond basically became non-existent, the entire side over there really got heavily weeded in, and that's actually not where anything got worked on. So I think that's why all the weeds came back. You can see them wood duck houses over there. That's actually pretty close to the edge of the pond. The edge of the pond is about 6 feet behind those wood duck houses. And normally, it would just be water all the way across. You wouldn't have those weeds. I'm assuming that in the next couple of years, most of these weeds will probably end up disappearing as we get more and more water in it. I think last year was kind of a fluke, and we probably won't be dealing with as much of a drought as we did last year, although it's been pretty bad. The past 5 weeks we haven't got much for rain. We're due for rain tomorrow, which is also another reason why we're out here shooting the video tonight. But hopefully we get some rain tomorrow. That would help out a lot. So I know the pond is massively down from where it was here about a month and a half ago. Probably about, if I was to guess, maybe about 10 inches down or a foot down. That area right out there is actually an island in the middle of the pond. And you can see I got a little thing out there. It's basically a pallet with a few boards attached to it and a roof for a little bit of a duck blind. But all of this now has been seeded in and is starting to grow. And hopefully we'll have all the ground cover in here real, real soon and back to normal. Got this area over here that has basically just been chest high weed. I think what Sarah and I have decided, we're gonna actually put in a medicinal herb garden in this area rather than having all these weeds back here. And that pretty much takes us right up to the edge of our property here on the west, where surprisingly enough, there's another drainage ditch. But it's amazing. All of this stuff that looks like weeds, and then you go in there, start figuring out exactly what's what, and it turns out that a lot of that stuff is very, very useful. You can see them elderberry plants back there, and if you look right through that gap there, very tall elderberry bush right there as well. I went up that hill and it looks like I went mudding or something. I'm covered in dirt. Shouldn't have probably gone up there, but that's okay. I think Sarah's pretty excited about the municipal herb garden that we're gonna put here. We'll have to kind of figure out how to do that, keep everything separate. We'd like it to be pretty much wild, but I know with that, you're gonna have to control some stuff. Otherwise the weeds are just gonna choke everything out. So we'll have to see how that's gonna go. I think you've already probably started a pretty big list of things that you'd like to put in here. and start acquiring some of the seeds and everything like that. So,
right.
So this is going to be a big focus next year. Although I think next year is going to be a really, really big year for us. We have a lot of plans for many, many things, more chickens, more garden, medicinal garden, greenhouses. And what I'm going to show you guys next is also a pretty big plan for next year as well. So got the back half of the pond here. Like I said, there's a lot of weeds out there, and that's not usually how it looked. It really dried up last year, and a lot of those weeds kind of took hold, and they're probably going to stick around for a couple of years. But I wouldn't be surprised if it went back to water and kind of cleaned itself out. But this area here on the north, Sarah and I are kind of calling it the North Field. Basically, this is just like canary grass as far as the eye can see back here. And we're either thinking about using it as a hay field or maybe letting some chickens come out here, or who knows. I teased her earlier today. I said, let's get some cattle and let them graze out here. So this is a pretty good sized area. This area here is about 31,000 square feet. So we could do a lot with it. We're willing to take suggestions. Pretty much anything's on the table as far as what we want to do. But like I said, who knows, maybe it'll just be a hay field or something. We have quite a bit more property to the north that we could go to with it if we wanted to. But who knows, maybe we should just plant pumpkins out here and call it good. 31,000 square feet of pumpkins. That'd be a pretty good pumpkin patch, wouldn't it? So, I don't know what we'll do, but it's a pretty sizable area, and it was definitely utilized years and years ago. So I know in the 60s they were out here farming all this, and you know, it's definitely usable land. So you can see I got another deer stand over there on the west side. So we got lots of deer here, that's for sure. I got a couple of good buddies that like to come up here and hang out and go sit in a tree stand. Or I should say fall asleep in a tree stand. What did you find?
Nothing, I was just looking at it. I just haven't spent as much time out here as you have.
Well, most of the time I've spent out here has been sitting on a machine. Either that or tracking deer. Yeah, there's a lot of jewel weed out here. It's amazing. Well, we got a lot of poison ivy too, but yeah. So, I mean, I didn't.
Nice.
Yeah, it's real nice, but yeah, I didn't show that when we were walking through the woods there, but yeah, there's enough poison ivy out there. Thankfully, I don't think I'm allergic, so.
Yeah, I guess I haven't rolled in it yet, but I prefer not to.
All right, come on, dogs, let's go. Come on, Sadie Tool, let's go. Well, maybe we could just turn it into a dog park.
My sister would like that.
Yeah, we could have maybe 75 or 80 dogs running around out here. Got my discaro sitting here. Actually, kind of funny, it was sitting right over there. That's where I found it. So, covered that in a video. Ran into it with my shin and didn't think much of it. And then went back out the next year and figured it belonged to my neighbor. So I went and asked him. He said, oh, shoot, you can have that if you dig it out. It's all yours. So, kind of cool. Let's take a look at the view from up here. Hey Sadie, what are you doing? Man, I can't wait till this all grows in. Sick of looking at the dirt. It sure will be nice. The actual size of the pond I measured at one time it's about 9/10 of an acre when it's full in the spring. That's where the water's edge goes to. Got the dock out there. Got to do a little bit of leveling on it still. Couldn't do it by myself, so get Sarah's help probably here tomorrow. We'll get that all fixed up, but it's looking real good. Well, like I mentioned before, this area here where we normally plant our garden, this area I think is about 29,000 square feet. This year we kind of are condensed down to a much smaller area because of that big old dirt pile, but we got quite a bit of stuff going in here. Sarah's got a lot of zucchini and cucumbers going and pumpkins and all kinds of stuff. And we, like I said earlier, we just started picking some of our first zucchini for the year. And I don't think the other stuff will be too far behind. And I noticed the corn started tasseling this week. It's not real tall. We've had kind of a bit of a drought, like I mentioned, but I think we're gonna get some rain here real soon. Either that or we're gonna put the sprinkler to it and get it going real quick. So all that should start being ready here in the next few weeks. And I planted it actually, it's staggered. So the stuff down there on the far right, that was planted first. The stuff down here on the left was planted about a week or week and a half later. And I think the stuff in the middle was a couple of weeks after that. So that way it staggers it out, not only for us to eat it, but also if we put it out on the vegetable stand, it makes it so that we have corn a little bit longer than you know, everything's ready on a Thursday and gonna be junk by a Tuesday. So makes everything last. I built this thing a few years ago. This is basically, it looks like an old corn crib. Sarah's got some stuff growing in there. She's pretty proud of her loofah plant that's doing pretty good. Although we're not seeing too many flowers on it yet, but.
Hey, it's gotten further than it ever has in the last 5 years. Every time I've planted, it's been an epic fail. So
yeah, that's
even
true.
Even if this is all it does, I'm excited.
Actually, it's kind of crazy. I don't know if you can see it up there on the roof. It's coming through. So those look like flowers up there. I don't know. But we haven't used the corn crib for corn. We pretty much, it's become like pool equipment and tubes and stuff, storage for the pool. So you gotta have the pool. Can't have a farm without a farm pool that the kids need to play in. So looking pretty good. I've spent about 100 million hours out here keeping it clean. So this is where we put the greenhouses this year. Last year, this was one long greenhouse that sat about where our corn is this year. But we ended up putting them here. Kind of got a table for supplies in this one. And planter boxes full of green beans and beets. If you've been keeping up with Sarah's garden tours, you've seen the progress on those. Those things are coming along like crazy. And won't be long now until we're harvesting out of there. And in the other greenhouse over here is our gigantic zucchini plants that are probably just about ready to start going. And we got quite a few pepper plants that Sarah's quite proud of as well that are doing good. My tomato experiment is doing about 70%. So I have two plants down there that I've transplanted a couple of times, and I don't know if it's the buckets or what it is. It's they're not working. So the other ones are coming along pretty good. We'll have to wait and see. We started everything super, super late, so I'm not expecting a whole lot. Although, you know, our tomatoes usually do pretty good until October. We usually do a lot of harvesting in October, and I wouldn't be surprised if we ended up getting stuff out of them. So that's kind of cool and something to look forward to. Well, and then to wrap up our tour here, this is something that we tried this year for fun. We took this little chunk of land and basically threw every seed that we had in the house at it. We got everything growing out here. I think Sarah even put asparagus out here, which I didn't get to do much, but We got corn. I think that in this small little area here, there is something like 4,000 seeds of corn or something. I think we put down about 2,000 bush bean seeds. I think there's 400 pumpkin plants. Trying to remember some of the other stuff. Tomatoes, all kinds of stuff. Sunflowers, snap peas, tons of stuff. Yeah.
Squash.
Yep. All kinds of stuff.
Cantaloupe.
We just threw it in here. It's a little late. I think that if this corn, like I said, we need rain. That's the biggest thing. But so I don't know. It's kind of a fun experiment. A lot of stuff out here. You can wander around. There's plants all over the place. So I don't know what we'll get out of it, but whatever we get is going to be pretty cool. So I'm pretty excited about it. Who doesn't like trying new things? Who doesn't like experimenting? So we'll see what we get. Well, I think that'll about wrap up our tour. Like I said, I'm open to suggestions. Anybody sees anything out here that we should do, you know, see a little area. Oh, you guys should do this or you should do that. You know, sky's the limit. Just make the suggestions in the comments. We'll probably give it a try. We like trying new things and experimenting and learning, and that's all that this has been about. So in 5 years, we've learned a heck of a lot. We've built a lot of stuff and created a lot of stuff, grown a lot of stuff.
Some really good experiments that worked out great and some not so great.
Yeah, a lot not so great. But anyways, thanks for coming along on the tour. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you're out there right now and you're watching this video and you're thinking about doing this and you'd like your property your own, you won't regret it.
The biggest failures are the ones you never even start.
Be inspired. Sky's the limit on your dreams. Every single day, Sarah and I learn something new. Every single day I come out here and I make mistakes. There's mistakes riddled all over this property of things that we've done, things that we've tried that were complete failures, but we took that, we learned from it, and we got better. And a lot of what you see out here, the way that we do grow things, that's just a learning experience. You know, we started out with, I think, a handful of chickens and that was it. And we were pretty much scared to death that they were gonna run off and never be seen again, but that wasn't the case. You know, if you have an opportunity or this is your dream, make it happen. Don't wait around. Don't wait for anybody to tell you can't do that or you shouldn't do that. You know, go make it happen for yourself. I don't think you'll regret it. It's a pretty great life. So thank you. Have a great night, and we hope that you enjoyed the tour. Thanks for coming along.
And remember to like and subscribe.
Look at that windmill. I can't believe how calm it is here. There's not even a breeze.
Yeah, that never happened.